Good morning.
Good morning.
Ding, ding. All right. If you have any visitors, please look at the pew in front of you. There's a little visitor's card that you can put in the offering plate or hand to the pastor at the end of service. At the back of the bulletin, we have our calendar that we'll read after announcements. Anybody have any announcements? Great, I don't have to call anybody. Sweet. Yes.
So we have Rally Sunday coming up September 9th. In the morning is going to be our normal, what we do on Rally Sunday, where we have donuts and do sing along and all that kind of stuff. In the evening, we're going to have car rally with those cars that you get when you do big Boy Scout car rallies and stuff.
Pinewood Derby.
Pinewood Derby, that's it. So we will have some samples available next week to look at. If you are unsure about how you do a Pinewood Derby car, you can take, pick one, and we have a wonderful volunteer, Dixon, who will be willing to carve them for us. Or you can take a home cart yourself if you want to have a fun time with that. This is primarily for kids, but there will be an adult heat, so any of you adults that want to get in there. And then on August 26th, that Sunday afternoon,
all right, so today is the 29th. We'll have fellowship after worship service, and Pine July was last week, right?
Yeah.
Okay, want to make sure I'm not seeing double. All right, and then Tuesday the 31st, we'll have holy yoga at 5:30, and then next Sunday the 5th, worship service at 11, and then fellowship right after that. As my mom said, the 9th of September, we'll have the Pinewood Derby race, and then please pay attention for more details as they come up. And please sign up for lay leader and fellowship host. Seeing some empty stuff up there.
So I take it in the fact that I left Pie in July on. No one fell for it. We're not having anybody show up. Yeah, that's my fault.
Yes, Tara.
We're having a food drive for the food pantry at Safeway. There is a sign up in the back. We're asking the churches to have two people at each church for each session, 4-hour sessions from 8 a.m. to noon to 4, and then 4 to 8, if it works out that way. I'm also, there's a lot of potatoes at the pantry that we're trying to get rid of, so I plan on being there on Wednesday from 9 a.m. to noon just to give out potatoes to anyone who wants them in the community. I'll put it on Facebook, most like Sell and Trade, possibly Craigslist, to just get the potatoes out. It's so hot in there that I don't think we're gonna make it. So if you have any questions, just ask me and I'll be the fellowship call.
There are no other announcements. Let's turn to the call to worship in the front of our bulletin. Today's call to worship is from, I believe that's Psalms 119, 33, and 40. Lord, teach me your ways, and I will follow them. Help me understand your word.
I will obey your teachings as best as I possibly can.
Help me think about your covenant instead of worthless things. Help me live your way.
Lord, your wise decisions are good. Help me love your word.
And now, out of the little red book, number 219, we will sing Our God Reigns.
Thank you.
key of B flat. Oh, I
yes, sir?
Totally read that wrong. Okay.
Do we want to play it again? And I'm sorry.
Let's do verse two.
So are we playing all six verses? Is that how we're working this red book?
Yeah, we're looking at that one. I just haven't had any coffee yet this morning, and I misread two flats as the E-flat. So that's a music thing that Oscar, he had no stately form. Let's try from there.
Okay.
When you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not deceive one another. Do not swear falsely by my name and so profane the name of your Lord, of your God. I am the Lord. Do not defraud your neighbor or rob him. Do not hold back the wages of a hired man overnight. Do not curse the deaf, put a stumbling block in the front of the blind, but fear your God. I am the Lord. Do not pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbor fairly. Do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Do not hate your brother in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so that you will not share his guilt. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against one of your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. And from the New Testament, Matthew 5, verse 43 and 48, on page 1503. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than the others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let's pray together.
Lord, as a young man, as I started to seriously read your word and came across Psalm 119, I instantly fell in love with it. Many people have many favorite psalms. Psalm 23 tends to be very popular. But the idea that Psalm 119 is dedicated to the person expressing their relationship with you through the word is foundational for me. And when I often don't know what to pray, I go to the Psalms and I borrow those words. And so from the Psalm this morning, Lord, the psalmist says, "Teach me your laws and I will follow them. Help me to understand and I will obey your teachings. I will obey them completely. Lord, lead me along the path of your commands. I truly love that way of living." And God, all of this is true. I borrow these words from the psalm with great joy. And I also recognize, Lord, that all too often we intend to live like this and yet fall by the wayside. We don't exactly follow the path of your commands. Sometimes we decide that we are just flat out going to go our own way. Forgive us for when we trespass. We don't often use that word for sin in this particular congregation. When we pray our Lord's Prayer, we use the term debtors. But there is definitely a sense that we can wander off on ourselves. And so, Lord, for the times we have done that, please forgive us. Please restore us and renew us and put us back on the path of righteousness. Help us to think about your covenant instead of our own needs. The psalmist continues and says, "Lord, don't let me look at worthless things. Help me live in your way. Do what you promised for your servant so that people will respect you." There's a piece in this psalm that brings in the idea that other people watch us, that other people are noticing how we live. And there's a lot of weight to that, Lord. And so we pray that we would be, as best we can, godly people, reflective of your values and your character. We pray for those who are on the our prayer list and the bulletin. We lift these names up to you week after week. Some of the people have been in this list, I'm sure, longer than I have been minister in this church. And we trust, Lord, that you will meet their needs in your way, in your time. For those who need healing, we ask that you would place your hand on them and you'd heal them right away. And we have seen you do that. We have seen healings that have been awfully quick, and we're thankful for those. And we have seen times when the healing has been much more slow, and we thank you for those. And we have seen times when we've asked you to change someone's diagnosis or heal them from a disease, and you have not chosen to do so. And while it's harder, we thank you for those as well. You have given us this privilege and opportunity to come to you in prayer and to lift up these names and situations, some of which we talk about, some of which we don't, and trust that you will care for them as the Lord and King of the universe who holds all things in your hand. The last verse of this section of the psalm that I've been reading is, "Look, I love your commands. Be good to me and let me live." Lord God, we do
want that to be true.
We want to love your commands. Of course, we want you to be good to us. We want you to let us live. And just to add a caveat, Lord, we want to do that on your terms and not just ours. So minister to us and through us so that we can truly be like Jesus, the one who taught us to pray together when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing together, Lord Be Glorified, number 344. Prepare to study the word this morning. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to come and speak to us, prepare our hearts and minds to hear what the word has. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, breath of God, hoverer over the waters all the way back in the beginning, we ask that you would come and hover over us today as well. That you would, the way the scripture describes it, disturb the waters. I'm thinking of that guy who was sitting by the pool of Siloam, and he wanted to get in the water, and whenever the water would be disturbed, then first person in would get healed. But he was crippled, and other people who were sicker were a little spry, and so that poor guy was stuck there for years and years and years because he couldn't get in the water fast enough. Until Jesus came along and says, you know what, let's just skip all the water bit and let's just heal you directly. Holy Spirit, we want to be healed. We want to be changed and transformed and made into the people you want us to be. And that's not something we can do in our own strength and power. That just never works. And so, Spirit, we'd ask that you would hover over us, that you would disturb us, stir us up, and make us want to be like Jesus. It's his words that we're going to be looking at this morning, and Lord, these are challenging words. This is not just an easy concept, because Jesus draws the line in the sand and says, this is what it means to be a part of the kingdom. So help us to hear this clearly, to process this well, to figure out how we can incorporate this into our own lives. Lord, if there's anything just of Ed in this sermon, I pray that you'd make it go away and forget that only what is left from the word would remain and shape us. And so, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As I was preparing this sermon on the topic of ministry, that's what we're going to look at this morning, I came across another sermon written by a gentleman, and his sermon opener was so good, I'm going to rip it off lock, stock, and barrel. I'll just tell you that right now. This is from Rick Warren's, one of his sermons on ministry. He found in a Parade magazine an article about Elvis. Parade magazine interviewed Elvis's wife and asked about how Elvis lived his life, because let's face it, one of the most successful musicians of all time. In fact, it is still true that Elvis is the highest paid musician ever, having been dead for a long, long time, but his estate still brings in more money and more royalties than any other musician. You could say he's still at the top of his game. But Elvis was not happy with his life. This is what his wife said, Parade magazine. Elvis never came to terms with who or what he was meant to be or what his purpose in life was. He thought that he was here for a reason, maybe to preach or to save or to serve and care for people, and that agonizing desire was always in him, and he knew he wasn't fulfilling it, so he'd go on stage and he wouldn't have to think about it. Elvis hadn't a clue about where to begin to look. In a sense, he was lost. Elvis' life was successful, but not fulfilled. And I believe one of the reasons why people's lives can be fulfilled is they understand not only that they are here for a purpose, but they understand what that purpose is. You are not just a random person who has been stuck on a rock spinning through space with no eternal significance. You can change the universe. The biblical world is cosmos. All that you see, all that you experience, you have the ability to change that. In fact, I'd go so far as to say you not only have the ability to change that, you have the mandate to change that. Change your world. Well, how do you do that? There is so much that could be done. And look around. We're not a huge church. It's not like I'm preaching to millions of people here. How do we prevent ourselves from getting burned out and yet prevent ourselves from being overwhelmed with there's so much to do and Lord, where do I start? And how do I know what I'm supposed to be doing? That is where this sense and call of ministry comes in. We're going to look at two portions of Scripture today, one in the New Testament and then one in the Old Testament, and then we'll get back to Jesus' words in the New Testament. To start things off, if you would open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to look at a portion of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Now, while you're turning to that, it's page 1503 in your pew Bible. Just a reminder, the Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' first public declaration of this is why I'm here. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. And he talks about what the kingdom of God is like. And just so that we understand why he preaches what he preaches, we've got to have a little insight as to whom he was preaching to. He's preaching to the people of Israel. They are God's chosen people. They've known that for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. They, out of all the people in the world, God has chosen for a specific thing. And so they've become very accustomed to being, in their minds, at the top of the world and overseeing everything. And Jesus comes along as an itinerant rabbi and preaches a sermon on a hillside and basically says, guys, you think you know the heart of God, and yet you've missed. Let me hit the reset button for you here. And so he explains in Matthew chapter 5 and 6 and 7 what the kingdom of God is supposed to be like, how we're supposed to live in it. And so I'm going to pick us up at verse 43, and I'm going to read through verse 47 to start off. 43, you have heard it said, I love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward do you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? So this opening statement that I read, you have heard it said, Jesus has used over and over and over again in his sermon here. In fact, he introduces this teaching pattern for the kingdom. And so if we're going to learn what it means to be a person on purpose, we got to grab a hold of this. We've got to see kingdom standards. If we're going to be a person on purpose, we've got to see kingdom standards. And the kingdom standards that he sets off in using this pattern over and over is that here's what you've already been taught. You're the chosen people. You've grown up with the Torah. You know this. So this is the level of the law that everybody knows, the level of the law. You have heard it said, don't steal. You have heard it said, don't break your oath. You have heard it said, eye for an eye. And in this particular instance, you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. This is your bottom line acceptable level of law. And then Jesus says, okay, that's good. That's fine. I'm not saying the law is wrong. I'm just saying it doesn't go far enough. And then the next thing he introduces every time he does this is a goal of godliness that frankly seems impossible. Love people. Yeah, that's good. Jesus says, love your enemies. Lord, time out. If by definition they're our enemies, if we love them, then they can't be our enemies. So they're mutually exclusive. You can't love your enemies because then they stop being your enemies. I rather think that's the point. But when Jesus says that, it gets so uncomfortable for his hearers, for us, that we're now. Wait a minute, can you unpack that a little bit? I mean, love, you're probably assuming love your enemies in some weird spiritual way that I can get away with only on Sunday mornings, right? No, he goes on to explain this practice of piety in this case, it's verses 46 to 47. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Everybody does that. Pagans do that. Tax collectors do that. If you greet only your brothers, well, doesn't everybody do that? Instead, greet those who don't greet you. Love those who don't love you. Boy, Lord, I don't know if I could do that. That seems to be a pretty radical departure from what we've always understood the law to be. So let me take you back to the Old Testament and show you that maybe Jesus' idea of doing this isn't quite so radical and off script as people thought. So now I'm going to ask you to go back to Leviticus, all the way back to Leviticus chapter 19. Janica read this for us earlier. Now, Leviticus is a section of law that if you're going to be a Levitical priest, this is your standard of behavior. You agree that if you're going to be a priest and you're going to be up front ministering for the whole nation of Israel, these are the laws that you are going to have to follow. Now, the Ten Commandments, as an example, are in Exodus. They are not the Levitical priest law, that's the law for everybody. But Leviticus has a whole bunch of additional laws. This is the laws that say things like, you're not supposed to shave. You're not supposed to shave the sides of your head. You're not supposed to get clothing that's made out of a mixture of fibers. If you find a ceramic bowl with mildew in it, you got to break it because you can't ever get that stuff out of there. That's an oddly specific law. I'm sorry, if that's incorrect. If you find a wood bowl with mildew in it, you have to break the wood bowl. If it's ceramic, you could scrub it off, you'll be fine. But if it gets into the wood, the whole thing's toast. Why these oddly specific laws in Leviticus? I want us to look at Leviticus 19. We're going to look at a series of laws here from 9 to 18. And when we get to the last one, I'm hoping it will all become clear. But we're talking about the practice of piety, right? So, verse 9. When you reap the harvest of your land, don't reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. That phrase, the way it's stated, is stated the same way that the very first commandment, I am the Lord your God, you will have no other gods before me. Law. And yet, this law says you are not going to harvest absolutely everything because you have to care for the poor and the alien among you. Law. It's written in the same kind of structure. So, okay, let's keep going. Let's pull on this thread a little bit more. Verses 11 and 12. Do not steal, do not lie, do not deceive one another. Okay, we know what these laws are like. Yeah, okay. Verse 12, do not swear falsely by my name and so profane the name of the Lord your God. I am the Lord. Yes, we are, in fact, reading Old Testament law. And there's we tend to read that with a certain, I don't know, lens in our mind. Laws are important. They make a difference. But what I want you to see is that because Scripture is the best commentary for Scripture, you have to realize that when Jesus is on the mountainside in Matthew 5 and he's preaching to the gathered people of Israel, he has read Torah. He studied it. He is, Matthew 5, commenting on earlier law that they all should know but probably don't remember. Jamie, can I share your... Okay. I got a phone call this week. You could have said no, but since you didn't know what I was talking about, I'm going to take advantage of that. I got a phone call this week. Honey, when I get that tone, it's like, yes. I had a very nice encounter with a policeman today. And I'm thinking, oh no, what happened? I got a ticket. What did you do? She doesn't speed. If I go 3 miles an hour over the speed limit when we're on a trip, I hear about it. She doesn't speed. So it can't be that. She wouldn't have hit anybody. She feels bad if a bird doesn't fly out of the way fast enough and she conks it. When a bird flew into her car and is flapping around inside, she just like, shoo, doesn't try to kill the bird or what, just let's, what on earth could she have done? She forgot to register the car, the tabs. Because honestly, we're used to the system where the state sends us the little bill in the mail. She gets the bill. She sees, oh, well, I got it. So she writes the check, sends that off. Then they send the little tabs in the mail. This is where I come in because the license plate is dirty and icky. Honey, go put this on that's my job. She does the paying and the tracking and all that stuff. I just put it on there. So she's driving my car and gets pulled over and doesn't have the correct tab on it. And she's shocked. What do you mean? And he says, I'm sorry, ma'am. You haven't paid the licensing on this vehicle for 2 years. Now, being off by maybe a month or two, I could see that 2 years? I mean, this is hardened criminal type stuff, right? And she explains this. I'm sure if you say I didn't, then I will go right over and do that. I'm very sorry. But the method that we use to track that stuff didn't work. So technically, the law was broken. But it's not a lot. It's not like she was a dangerous driver or something awful to, you know, she's not burning rubber. She's not drag racing on Broadway in Moses Lake. None of that's happening. You know, Fast and Furious 9, pastor's wife goes nuts. None of that is happening. It's a matter of funds not being paid to a particular licensing. So she paid the funds, and now we have the right color sticker, and we're all good. But the law is the law. And that policeman could have written her up for a whole lot worse. The law is the law. And we see that here in Leviticus. And it's not messing around. This, you don't do these things. But then there's some additional content to the law that we may not necessarily think about very often. Look at verse 13. 14, 15, do not defraud your neighbor or rob him. Do not hold back the wages of a hired man overnight. Don't cheat or swindle. Okay. 14, do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind, but fear your God. I am the Lord. Do not take advantage of a person who can't hear you very well and say snarky things. Members of my own family are giggling about this because they know. Don't tell jokes that dad can't hear. That's not cool. Don't ask dad to do a thing when dad is turned away from you and is walking out of the room and then say, well, I told you to do that. Not my fault you didn't. Okay. In other words, do not taunt. Taunting is against Levitical law. 15, 16. 17. Don't pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbor fairly. Do not go about spreading slander among your people. Be fair to everyone. Don't pander to the poor. Don't revere the rich, but be fair to everyone. Do not slander or endanger someone. Don't do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Don't do something so stupid that your neighbor could die from it. That's in the law. Now, granted, this is Levitical law. This is intended for the priests. I kind of think, okay, priests, Levitical priests, they have a big fire that's always going in the temple. Men, fire. Stupidity could happen. So there's a warning in the law. Don't be stupid, okay? Don't put people in danger. Verse 17, do not hate your brother in your heart. And I think this is where Jesus starts to get this idea that he's going to riff on in Matthew. Do not hate your neighbor in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly, so you will not share in his guilt. If your neighbor is doing something that is driving you crazy, Israelite, don't just silently hate him for it and grind your teeth down to flat nubs. Talk to him. Go talk to your neighbor and work the stuff out so that it doesn't drive you crazy anymore and you don't drive him crazy anymore and you have peace. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against one of your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. When Jesus was asked in the New Testament by a bunch of people who wanted to test him and make sure that he knew the content of his law, what's the most important law in all of the Old Testament? And Jesus does not go to the Ten Commandments. Instead, he goes to the Shema, Deuteronomy 6:4, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one, and you will love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. This is the correct answer. And if he'd stopped there, we're like, okay, Rabbi knows his stuff. This is good. He says, and the second is like it. They didn't ask for a second, but he's going to give it to them anyway. And he gives them this verse from an obscure section of Leviticus. Love your neighbor as yourself. It's the second most important law, according to Jesus, in all of the 613 laws that make up the law code in Torah. So now we go back to Matthew, recognizing that all of Jesus' teaching is, in a way, commentary on the Old Testament law. We not only need to see kingdom standards, we need to live kingdom concepts. We don't just say, yeah, I think that it's pretty important for us to care for people. No, I've seen you do it. You bring foods to the foyer for the food pantry, and you donate funds for it, and some of us go down there and volunteer. We act to change the world. We see kingdom standards that Jesus is talking about, and then we live in kingdom concepts. We see that the bare standard is one thing, but we need to go beyond that. So why am I talking about all of this? Because ministry is a very specific to the person thing. This was way before Jamie, had a friend, girl, not a girlfriend, because we hadn't got that close yet, but a gal that I was going to Bible school with. She was really cute, and she loved Jesus. She could sing. I'm a young man. I'm looking for cute girls who can sing, who love Jesus. I thought, okay, this could work. We decided we're going to go out on a date, and we had a wonderful date. And in the process of that date, we started talking about what we wanted to do and where we thought God was calling us and what our eventual ministry was going to be. And I'm called to work in the church as a pastor, specifically a youth pastor at the time. But, you know, I knew I was headed for work in the church. She was convinced God was calling her to go work with orphans in Mexico. She had no doubts. This is where I am headed. And so we really enjoyed one another's company and thought each other a good match for somebody, but not for each other, because our ministries didn't match. I didn't want to pursue her and have us fall in love and then get married and then have one of the other of us always be frustrated because, well, we're not in Mexico ministering to orphans, or, you know, we're not doing ministry in church someplace. So we decided, okay, off you go. She came to our wedding. Cassie, neat little gal. Now she's married, and I don't know whether she ended up in Mexico or not. Now she lives in Seattle. But we recognize that God puts specific ministries, specific calls to do certain things in certain people. And they do not all have to be the same ministry. If you feel like God has put in your heart a desire to sing, then sing. My dog has this gift. If I go long enough and the bells happen at noon, you'll hear him. He'll be just on the other side of there singing his little guts out. He doesn't like anybody else to watch. So if I happen to walk outside, good singing, he'll stop, like, can you go away, please? I was singing. It's a little personal, you know, Buddy the church puppy. I think it'd make a great children's book. You might not be able to carry a tune in a bucket, and that might not be your thing. So you serve. When it comes time for putting the spread out for whenever we have a funeral meal, you're there serving. You wash dishes. You rewire electrical things, knowing that if you left that up to pastor, the building would have burned down. You call people. You care for them. You visit them in the hospital, and then only after call me and like, oh yeah, pastor, so-and-so's in the hospital. You should probably go visit. I'm the guy with the title pastor, but you pastor each other very well. God has placed in each one of us a ministry, a purpose. And so the point of this sermon is to help you recognize, identify what that purpose is, and then engage, get out there. Use whatever that thing is that is in you to change the universe. Recognizing you can. And you do. Matthew 5:48, the end of this section. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. The word perfect here means complete, finished. Finish the job that God has put in you to do. But Lord, the job that God's put in me to do won't ever be finished. We Jamie and I have had conversations about this, realizing that someday I will need to retire. And that will probably just mean that I won't be standing in this particular pulpit every single Sunday. But we go down to visit Ingle Chapel. They have a Pastor Ed. And their Pastor Ed's been there 40-some years. He doesn't preach every Sunday. He retired decades ago. But he's still Pastor Ed. And he's still there ministering to and caring for people. He's never going to finish the work. You'll notice it doesn't say, get to the point where you're finished with the work and then stop. It says, be perfect, be completed. Figure out what your job is and get to it. Because that's what God does for us. Let's pray. Lord, this sermon on ministry is really a short little commentary about Jesus encouraging us to engage. More than we think we already know. And this isn't do more, be more piety, be more pious. That's not where I'm going. But more along the lines of, Lord, cause me to re-examine what I think you're calling me to do and to make sure that that's what in fact you're calling me to do. And if I am engaged in the work that you have placed me in, give me power and ability to do it. Because it's all about building your kingdom, not about building our stuff. We're looking for this completion of Christ-likeness in us. And that's not something that we complete in and of our own self. Help us to surrender to your work and to continue to do it in a way that brings you glory. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing Make Me a Servant, number 445, and then we'll have baptism.
Make me a servant.
and there we go. This will work. Okay. Now, Carlos asked me some time ago if I would baptize him. In fact, you asked me years ago if I would baptize you. And my answer was basically, what?
That was very good.
Yeah. So now you are. Would you like to tell us a little bit about why that is and how you come to this point?
Well, I want to make sure I'm not really good at speeches, and a lot of you don't know who I am, for, you know, where I used to be, I'm in a gang and all that. And I did some time at the beginning of the year, and even like I've been doing that for like for a long time, and I've been doing good, and all that does is set me back, and God helped me through in jail. He said, you know, Pastor Ann sent me a Bible in there that got me through, and I was like, man, I just want to say thank you for that, and thank you for church, you know, sending these books and all that too.
I got to tell you, I have a heart of an evangelist. That's part of my thing. The day I went and picked him up from his being released, we happened to give a ride to somebody else, and Carlos was preaching to this guy in gang speak. It was awesome. I was like, yeah, give it to him, Carlos. It was awesome. Because being baptized isn't some magical rite. This is a Scripture says this is a pledge of your good conscience towards God. That it's not just a washing, there's some spiritual marking that happens in this process.
Amen.
And so, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, and then I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. And the questions I have for you is, Carlos, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir, I have.
And will you follow him all the days of your life?
Sir.
Okay.
So that's to me.
Congregation, you've heard and witnessed this man's testimony. Will you be here to uphold him in his Christian walk? If so, say we will.
We will.
Will you extend to him fellowship and draw him into life of the church and say, okay, man, it's church work day, you gotta come show up.
No.
Will you make him a part of your life? So say yes. Or no.
Yes.
Okay. So Carlos, let me have you stand right here. On your right hand. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord God, thank you for my brother Carlos. I have been praying for this moment for years and years. I pray, Lord, that you would completely fill him with your Holy Spirit, that you would put in him a love for your word and a love for your people, that he would be filled with a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. Lord God, show his world that you can change anybody. We thank you for the example that he has chosen to stand up and live. Empower him for service, Lord. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now, let's receive our morning offering.
Thank you.
register, and at the same time, you always give us grace and peace and the ability to give back to you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes, we're going to do number 476, When We All Get to Heaven. Jennifer wants to play drums on this one, that's why she did an announcement. So, When We All Get to Heaven, here we go. Necessarily wants to shout. We're not a very shouty group of people. But someday we will stand in your presence and we will shout, we made it. We're home. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. We're so grateful that you have sought us and bought us and are bringing us home. Show us what our ministry is so that we can change our world, Lord. We ask this all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's join together in the fellowship.